It is an absolute honour to have you here at the East End Film Festival. How does it feel to be here in the heart of London kicking the whole festival off?
Is that what we're doing? We're kicking it off?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
This festival is a celebration of particularly the wonderful delights of independent cinema. It's something that you work a lot in and you really champion. What do you think it gives an audience and you as a performer that you perhaps don't get from working on big blockbuster productions?
Well, I've never seen anybody look at their watch on an independent cinema. I've never seen anybody walk from point A to point B. Everybody's just running like they're kindergartners. You know, there's a kind of an energy, a youthful enthusiasm that just reminds me of that original feeling that got me hooked on performing. And whereas when I'm on a big movie set, a big studio movie, people are constantly yawning and looking at their watch and hoping to go home. And I just don't think there's any place for that on a movie set. So I try to put myself in as many situations where I'm surrounded by young folks who feel like they're reinventing the wheel and that who have, you know, nothing to lose and everything to gain. So they're daring and bold and idealistic.
You've had such an extraordinary career. What do you look for in a role, and what was it about this particular project that made you jump on board?
This was the one project that I was determined to understand the meaning of, because it eluded me when I read it. And it eluded me when I shot it, and it still eludes me. I have no idea what the hell this movie's about. But I was quite charmed by Ross Clark, the filmmaker, and we became fast pals. And there was something very, very kind of adventurous about his passion for the material and his determination to find the cinematic value in it. And so, I'm all for a good adventure, especially with a filmmaker who's kind of more at the beginning of their journey than at the end, because there's a kind of purity and an enthusiasm that may get banged around along the way.
And one blockbuster director who you do have a very special relationship with is, of course, Guillermo, one of our favorite human beings, I must admit. What is it that you particularly get out of the experience of working with him? And I think the question that all fans all around the world still want the answer to, is Hellboy 3 ever going to be a reality? Because we'd very much like to see you slip on that coat one more time.
Well, my very first movie with Guillermo was, A Million Two. It was an independent film. In fact, he's the reason why I still do this. While he's now off kind of making Pacific Rim and $200 million movies, I'm still looking for the next Guillermo del Toro, which is why I do four or five or six of these little independent films a year, because it was the first time I ever identified what I was just describing earlier. It was up on that set in Mexico City with Guillermo. He was a first-time director. He'd never made a film before, so it was a real roll of the dice for all parties concerned, and it turned out to be a winner. And it turned out to unearth, one of the great contributors to cinema in the history of the medium. You know, he's not just a passing fancy. He's somebody who's already made a profound contribution. So to know that I was there at the outset, it's kind of like that's kind of like what makes me proud. To be able to say, I took a risk and got to witness history being made, and so I'm just constantly in search of that, and sometimes you hit and most of the time you miss. We'll see what the response to Dermaphoria is before we decide which category that falls into. But Ross is an adventurer. And a pure guy, looking to make a pure film.
being honest, is that a franchise that you want to keep going?
I'd like to keep it. I'd like to not keep it going. I'd like to finish it though. Yeah. I'd like for there to be a third film, because the first two films were set up for this huge resolve, and he already understands what that resolve will kind of look like. And in he never gave me the nuts and bolts of it, but he gave me a rather broad stroke sketch of what the third film would look like. And it's so epic, and it's so deserved by the fans who hung in there for the first two, that I really feel as though it's essential that we make it. So I fight for it every day. And sometimes I'm the only voice, and sometimes, you know, there are others, but I'm never gonna stop trying to get Hellboy 3 made.
Hi, my name is Nicole Badon, and I'm Desiree in the film Dermaphoria.
Nicole, it's fantastic to have you here in the heart of London. How does it feel to be opening the East End Film Festival this year?
Oh, I'm so excited to be here. I'm honored that I was invited here and that Dermaphoria is opening it is just a cherry on top of the sundae. So it feels wonderful. I'm very happy to be here.
And for people who haven't seen the film, obviously your character is entirely integral to the story. Can you tell us as much as you can without spoiling things?
Sure. So Eric is the lead character. He's a brilliant chemist who invents a drug that allows you to relive your past through sensation. He wakes up in a hospital, half of his memory is gone, and he takes his own drug to try and remember what happened to him and why he is in the current situation he is, and to find out who Desiree is. And that just happens to be me, but he doesn't know that yet.
Of course, you're working with an incredibly handsome and talented leading man. Can you tell us a little bit about that experience, what that was like?
Yeah, I was working with Joseph Morgan, who plays the role of Eric, and he was absolutely wonderful to work with. I hadn't known him before we met on set, and he was such an inspiration as an actor to see the way that he works on set with the way he handles different things, and he just goes for it every single time. And that's so refreshing to see, that it motivated me to do just the same and be on his level with him. So it was so wonderful to work with him, and I learned a lot.
Of course, I mean, the film jumps back and forth in time. It's a very fragmented narrative. I'm curious, was the shooting experience like that? Was it kind of difficult to keep track of things?
The shooting experience was also fragmented. We shot on location, so even though it does jump back and forth, we would shoot all like the hospital scenes at that location and then like that. To keep track of the film, I know that Joseph actually cut up the script, cut up each scene, and taped them together in what he believed was chronological order. So for his character, he was able to make the most sense of it as possible. And he had this really, really, really long scroll that he put in a vintage suitcase that he would carry around with him. So whenever someone had a question, they would go to Joseph, because he had a very long one-piece script.
I mean, talking about your character, she's quite an ethereal and quite a mysterious presence for much of the film. Did that impact how you kind of played it? And is it hard to embody all those kind of attributes and ideals?
Everything about Desiree absolutely impacted the way I played her. I wanted to do the best I could to fully become her as a person. I wouldn't say that it was any harder than playing any other character, because for each character, you have to do what's necessary to do them justice. But I can say that the role of Desiree is quite different from all the other roles and characters I played, because she was the least like myself. But it was just that much more fun. There are so many more things I allowed myself to learn because I didn't know about from my own life. So I got to experience them through her and through her eyes in a way, which was really fun.
Of course, I mean, the film has a very, very familiar face in the shape of the magnificent Ron Perlman. What does it mean for you to be in a film with him and to have a star like him supporting an independent production like this particularly?
Right. It's such an honor to be in a film with him. It was such an honor. When I first saw him on set, I was a bit starstruck, and I had binge-watched a bunch of episodes of Sons of Anarchy because I'd never seen them before, and I wanted to be prepared to meet Ron. So when I first saw Ron, I was expecting this motorcycle gang member, and he walks out of set in a Hawaiian shirt and these shorts, and he was just looking at me. I was like, I was starstruck. I didn't know what to say to him. But he's the kindest person, the nicest person. As you can see, he's very passionate about the project as well, which means so much.
When we spoke to Ron earlier and he shared that passion for independent cinema, I'm curious for you, what do you think it is that an audience and as a performer you get from independent cinema that you perhaps don't from a studio production?
I believe it's a bit of the freedom that comes with independent films. I feel as though you have some more creative freedom in terms of where you want to shoot or what you want the story to be or how you want to put it together, and there isn't a big studio that has to approve it. That also makes it a bit harder, but there are pros and cons to both. And I think the innovation, the inspiration, the creativity, the fact that the story may be something that a big budget film, big studio doesn't want, the fact that it's that creative just draws in a whole new audience that really is excited for something of that nature. I would just love for them to enjoy the film and watch it with an open mind and try to absorb as much of it as you can. One of my favorite parts of the film is what's displayed now in the film as the voiceover, and it was some of the text that was in the script and some of the original text from the book, discussing how everything is everything else. That's a bit of the motto from the book, and there's a beautiful paragraph in one of the chapters explaining how there's such a small fine line between something that's a poison and something that can allow life to grow, and I just thought that was so fascinating and really made me think. So take away the overall beauty of the film that Ross Clark created through his direction and listen for that quote, because it's beautiful.
We're here at the East End Film Festival. How important do you feel events like this are in supporting, nurturing, and encouraging the next generation of particularly directors and young stars like yourself?
I think they're so important. I think they are what keeps the independent film market alive. I think without festivals like this, independent films wouldn't have as much exposure. Not as much people would know about them, and perhaps not even have that many opportunities to go see them. But for a film like Dermophoria that's premiering here, it gave us that opportunity. So without the East End Film Festival, I'm not sure that would have been possible. And they definitely need to continue. So more of them, please.
What's coming up for you the rest of the year? Where are we going to see you next? Is there anything else you're working on at the moment?
Yes, a film that I wrapped up last year should be released later this year as well. I believe it's already released internationally. It's called Fast Track. And I have a bunch of other things in the works right now, so stay tuned.
Can you tell UK fans a little bit about Fast Track, what it's about, where you fit into that one?
Sure, yes. It's a sequel to the film Born to Race, about high school drag racing. And this is the film that follows two best friends and their struggles between competition and their own ego and whether or not they allow it to get between them. And I'm the girlfriend stuck in the middle of it all.
And have you enjoyed that? Who are you working with on that one?
On that one are two U.S. stars, Brett Davern, Bo Murchoff. Diogo Morgado is also in it. He's currently in Son of God. And it was also so wonderful to work with them as well. Such inspiration and such motivation from being surrounded by such talented people. It just motivates me to try that much harder and do work at that level as well.
Have you got a message to fans, particularly about this film and why they should be rushing out to watch it when they get a chance here in the UK?
Yeah, why not? It's an amazing film. It'll make you think about the way you've ever thought about everything. So watch it once, then watch it twice, and then watch it a third time, and then watch it a fourth, just because you should.
How does it feel to be kicking off this year's East End Film Festival?
It's great, but I'm a bit like a rabbit in the headlights, to be honest. But yeah, I can't quite believe all these people are here, and Alison and the team have done an amazing job, so it's fantastic.
For people who haven't seen the film yet, can you just give us a very brief synopsis and tell us where the inspiration came for writing it?
Well, it's adapted from a novel by a guy called Craig Clevenger, whose first novel I loved, Contortionist Handbook. And the story is about a guy who basically wakes up in jail, doesn't really remember much other than his girlfriend's name, and is desperately in search of her, but everybody else seems to want something else from him. He's been accused of arson, and he doesn't quite know what's happened. So the film is really about him working out what the hell happened to him. It's a kind of classic noir setup with a slight twist on the noir payoff, I think. And that's really what appealed to me about the story, was that, you know, it sort of wasn't the normal noir story. It sort of subverted the genre a bit. I think the main comparison I'd make with the film is that this probably sounds really pretentious, but I think it's more a poem than a piece of prose. Like, it makes sense as a story, but there are a lot of things that are left unanswered, and I wanted to reflect that also in the look of the film, so I wanted it to be beautiful. The city of New Orleans is, you know, kind of a beautiful city, and a really, you know, it's a run-down city. It's been destroyed by this storm, Katrina. Katrina figures in the movie as well, and I just wanted to reflect the beauty in that city. It's a perfect backdrop for the movie.
Is that a challenge as a director and as a storyteller, working with that kind of fragmented narrative?
It is a huge challenge, to be frank. I think in the edit suite, that is the biggest challenge, you know, because you kind of, you know, you make the movie three times. You make it when you write the script, you make it when you film it, and then you remake it the third time. And it was a long process of, have we given the audience enough information? Are they confused about where they are? I mean, it's a balancing act between, you want the audience to be confused, but you don't want them to be so confused that they're not interested in the story anymore. You know, I mean, a perfect example of that is something like The Usual Suspects, I think, or Angel Heart, where you follow this guy through this puzzle, but at the end you feel satisfied with the ending, I think. It was tough because he carries the whole movie. And we found him actually through a British casting director, even though Joe is British, he's Welsh, and even though he's based in America with The Originals and Vampire Diaries, and he's a huge heartthrob over there. I think he shows in this film that he's got real chops and that he really can do the leading man thing, and that this is very different from what he's been doing on CW, which he's fantastic at, but this is completely the opposite end of the spectrum. His audition tapes were incredible, so it was really a no-brainer for me once I'd met him that this was our guy. And you know, it's a big gamble because you know that the film won't work without the right guy in that part. You know, so yeah, it was good to have Joseph on board. We were very lucky.
Of course, the central MacGuffin of the story is his missing girlfriend. Can you talk about finding the right captivating beauty to embody that role?
Yeah, we wanted someone who is unknown, really, because I think she's someone that you can project a lot onto through the story. We want someone up and coming. And I met Nicole, and she's, you know, she's a great actress. She's very enthusiastic. And she's, you know, she's on her way up, but she's not someone that people have associations with immediately. And because of the sort of ephemeral, slightly, you know, untouchable nature of that character, she was perfect for that part. And she, you know, she embraced it wholeheartedly, and it's fantastic.
One face that fans will immediately recognise, the magnificent Ron Perlman. How significant was it for you to get a talent like him on board? And I mean, he represents, I guess, the central character's kind of only real friend, I guess, in some respects.
Yeah, he is the only friend, but he's really not his friend. And I think that's the interesting part of the story, is that this guy, and that's, I cast Ron, you know, I always wanted Ron to do it because I always wanted to cast him against type, where he plays the good guy, although there's a twist on that, obviously. But Ron was our first cast member. And that is very significant because people like Joseph, people like Walton, you know, if they know someone like Ron is going to do it, a guy who did, you know, Name of the Rose, Drive, Hellboy, you know, he's been so prolific and so brilliant in TV shows like Sons of Anarchy, then it really gave us a kind of stamp of authority. And casting is so crucial to these movies, getting them made even. So, yeah, Ron was really, you know, we had dinner together. I realised what an amazing, you know, not just a great actor, but what an amazing guy and a real cinephile he is. You know, he knows so much. He makes me feel like I know nothing about cinema. He knows so much about cinema. And he's just a very generous guy and very, you know, amazing to work with. So he actually was what set the ball rolling for us. So that was everything. you have a lot of voices on set, you have a lot of voices in the edit suite, you always have a lot of voices, whatever you're doing, any film. But I think with a film like this, you know, a smaller movie, smaller budgets, you know, still a significant cast, you get a latitude and a freedom that you wouldn't otherwise have. And I think some of the problems we were having, you know, early on in the edit, which seemed, you know, we weren't sure if we were going to get around them, I think we have now. You know, that's the stage at which a studio film, you might end up having other people make those decisions. The cool thing for me with the producers was that I was always in charge of that process, in charge of the edit, and they trusted me enough to do that. And I think that's one of the biggest advantages probably of making a film on this scale. I'm not quite sure I ever want to make a film on a bigger scale, because this was felt pretty big. You've got that many people running around, I'm kind of like, it's like, it feels like you're at war, it feels like you're in the army or something. So, you know, I'm not sure I could handle a bigger movie, but yeah.
You say that there were tough decisions to make in the editing and sort of problems along the way. I mean, can you tell us a little bit more about what those big decisions were and kind of how you addressed them?
Just really how you ground a character who is, you know, arguably unlikable to some degree. He's, you know, some of the things he's done are questionable, and I think that's why you need an actor like Joseph, because he has a charisma, he has an appeal on screen that helps that. And I think grounding him in terms of the story, I think we went for a route where we made an assumption about our audience that was probably overestimating what most people can follow. And that's not, I mean, we live in a, I think we live in a world where clarity is everything, and this was a less clear kind of story. So like I said, we had to walk that line, and one of the decisions was to really give a little bit more information up front to the audience, and that I think we'll see tonight, but I think that's made a big difference to how an audience can receive the movie.
When you have a morally ambiguous leading man, it's quite often helpful to set them off against even more odious and villainous presences, and I think Toe-Tag and his loving father certainly represent that. Can you talk about those characters and what they bring to the story?
I mean, to me, Walton is, you know, even though I love all the actors that I work with, Walton for me is the, you know, absolute genius of everyone. And, you know, there were days when I felt like almost handing the direction over to him. He's so great, he's so charismatic, he's so smart, he knows his character inside out. And he told me afterwards that he did this because he felt that he could do something different to anyone else, and he felt that this character could be the most interesting thing about the movie. And I agree. I think it, you know, one of those big decisions we made was that in the initial cut we had Walton's character appears about 20 minutes in. He now appears in the first 10 minutes. And I think it's significant that as soon as he's on screen, if you're not in at that point, I think you will be once he arrives on screen. And he's so captivating with his kind of John Walters channeling southern menace, you know. And yeah, I loved working with Walton. I would work with him again in a heartbeat. And he's just a brilliant actor who I think will get more and more plaudits as time goes on. I mean, it's not a happy story, let's be honest, but I guess it's really, you know, I think at its heart it's a love story, and I think it's a story about regrets and, you know, so I guess what I would hope that people take away a kind of vision of a world where people, you know, can kind of make mistakes and wondering whether those mistakes can be rectified. I mean, I don't want to tell anyone what to take away from it, really. I know why I liked it, and that was why I liked it, because I like those flawed characters. I think they're more interesting, more appealing, and, you know, and I like those kind of stories where you don't quite know where you are for most of the time, but there's a satisfying ending. There's a kind of denouement that gives you an answer that you go, oh yeah, I should have known that all along, but I didn't. And that, for me, that works.
Do you know what you're going on to next? Do you have other projects you're working on or currently considering?
Yeah, I do. I mean, we have a TV show in development with Channel 4, which is based on another series of books by a British writer called Derek Raymond, who wrote in the 80s. He was a crime novelist. He's kind of... He was the inspiration for people like David Peace, who wrote the Red Riding trilogy. I actually came to these books with David, who put me onto them. And it's kind of like, you can also see influences in Luther, and he was well ahead of his time, and he writes about actually East London. And I want to make something in my home neighborhood, and I would love that to be the next thing I do. And it's looking promising. I think it'd be a great TV show. And right now, you know, if you want to make a great crime content, TV is the place to do it. You know, all the great shows there are right now.
Do you have a cast attached or in mind for that at this stage?
I mean, I have people in mind for it. I mean, I made my first short with Mark Strong, and, you know, this Mark would be the perfect unnamed detective. I've never talked to him about that, but, you know. But, you know, we haven't got that far with it. We've got a great writer on board at the moment, Lee Patterson, working with Channel 4, and we'll see, you know, it's a long road, but we'll see where that ends up.
How important do you think it is for the East End to have an event like this, you know, a thriving celebration of cinema and the creative arts right here in the heart of the East End every year?
I mean, I think it's brilliant. I've lived here, you know, nearly half my life, and I've run clubs and festivals here and been involved in the music scene and now in the film, and yeah, this festival is fantastic. I actually showed, we made a documentary a few years ago called Skid Row, which was set in Los Angeles with Pras from the Fugees. We showed it here. You know, when Alison asked me to show for the opening gala, I was ecstatic. So yeah, I couldn't be happier to, and I think it's, you know, cinemas like this, the Genesis, are the sort of living heartbeat of what makes East London really interesting, which is independent businesses doing their own thing in the creative arts.
Do you have a message to audiences who haven't seen this film yet about why they should be rushing out and giving it a chance whenever it hits their local multiplex?
I think you should give it a chance because the acting is incredible. It looks amazing. And it will make you want to visit New Orleans, which is something you should do in any life.